I was thinking about, in a sense, there must be quite a balance in the society right now, because we've seen kind of terror attacks in France, we've seen them here in Denmark, we have a huge foreign population in Germany, but we haven't really had kind of a terror incident or something that seems to challenge our political system right now.
Fortunately, and I don't really know whether this is due to the good police or the good secret service, or maybe it's just good luck we had so far. But this can change from one day to the other. I mean, if you think about the airplane crash, was it last week or 2 weeks before?
It's the one in France.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think 3 weeks
ago. You know, everybody had the idea in the beginning it was either technical failure or it was a terrorist attack. And so we all thought that now terrorism comes back to Germany in form of an airplane crash. And everybody was expecting something like that. And I think the big echo the whole thing had, you can see that in the ratings on the internet. It really went up high into the sky when it came out that the co-pilot had a depression and you know, just set the plane into the mountains. So the people have the feeling that the security and the safety of the country and the stability of the country is a present of these days, but it can change from one day to the other. Mm. And I think this is really true. You can always have something, but I mean, when you see what's going on in the Mediterranean Sea, and all the problems with the immigrants we have, and the opposition against it, you know, right-winged actions again, like we had it in the 90s, in the beginning of the 90s, we can only hope that it will keep stable, and that so we are very lucky. I mean, we are lucky to live in boring times in a certain way.
But this kind of stability you talk about is a political stability as well. There are no really right-wing parties in the in some regional parliaments, but not on the country scale. Are you optimistic on behalf of the country? Do you sense this is a stable stability?
I mean, you can never know what's happening tomorrow, but I think if you compare it to a lot of other countries, to the rest of the world, it's a very stable country. And one of the big mistakes, some people say, of this government is that they do quite a lot for the poor people. So that we consume a lot, we put a lot into welfare programs and all this. But as long as we can afford it, it's very good to have stability of that side. Mm-hmm. Everybody can see that there are a lot of dangers around, and sometimes I have the feeling that we are living in a very dangerous situation. We have the Cold War in a certain way coming back, because of the Ukraine crisis and the crisis with Russia, and at the same time we are dependent on Russia, and it's very hard to see how we can get out of that trap. That's one thing. So the world is getting more divided than it was before. Then if you look at the problems with Greece, nobody knows what's happening when they really get out of the Eurozone, which will probably get... Actually, I have a lot of discussions about that with people, and I always say, I mean, Denmark doesn't have the euro, and it works. I mean, why not? I mean, why not having a country inside the euro, the European Union, and not having the same currency? Mm-hmm. So I cannot see the problem being that big, but you have no idea what happens. Mm-hmm. Actually, I was last night, because I'm working for Springer now. There is just an event there at Springer. This is what they really can do. They call it the Welt not because of the world, but because of the newspaper, Weltwirtschaftsgipfel, and we had a dinner, opening dinner last night, and Martin Schulz came and had a discussion with the German professor Werner Sinn. Heißt der Werner?
Yeah. Werner Sinn. Yeah.
And he Martin is very Schulz, radical.
The president of the European Parliament.
Martin Schulz is the president of the European Parliament, and they had a very strong discussion because Sinn thinks that it is necessary for Greece to get out, just in order to come back on their feet. But nobody really knows what happens. I think if Greece would have gotten out of the euro a couple of years ago, we had a big crisis because all the money we put in there, we didn't put into Greece, but into our banks, so that they wouldn't
save their,
they wouldn't go bankrupt. Mm-hmm. So maybe it's not going to be such a big problem, but nobody really knows. And what we can see in Northern Africa or all over Africa, and one of the reasons why so many people try to cross, get over the Mediterranean Sea, is because you have not only instability there, but the most terrible events and war than we had for a very long time. So I think if you look on Europe, if you look on Denmark and the northern European states, it looks rather stable, but around us, there are pretty much fires going on.
Yeah. The reason why I wanted to start in 2015 is actually to look back and see how did we come here. Because you were born in 1946.
That's true.
That's true. You have done quite a travel as well. You started with the St. Pauli Nachrichten.
No, that's not true, but I can tell you the story. Okay. I mean, I started with Concrete.
Yeah.
And that was just because I went to school in Stade, small city between Hamburg and Cuxhaven. Mm. And I was working for the school magazine together with a younger brother of Klaus Rainer Röhl. Mm-hmm. And Klaus Rainer Röhl was the publisher of Concrete and the husband of Ulrike Meinhof.
Exactly.
So that's why I knew Ulrike Meinhof when I still went to school. Mm-hmm. So, and because my parents didn't have a lot of money, I wanted to go to university, but it was Röhl asked me whether I wanted to work for Concrete, and that was very interesting. So I didn't start working there because I was left radical. Actually, I was not. Mm-hmm. So I didn't have to change so much. Adenauer died, Ulrike Meinhof told me, now your hero is gone. But that was not true. I was not that reactionary. But during that period of time, it was the students' movement, and that was very interesting. And
but so would you have imagined at the time that you wouldn't end up with a Springer concern?
Well, I'm not with the end already. I have some ideas which I'm not going to talk about here. Well, I'm always asked the same question, that actually I ended up, no, I didn't end up, I am at Springer now, because I was, after they threw me out at Spiegel, I didn't go voluntarily. Mm-hmm. They wanted to get rid of me because it was running very well and they thought everybody could it. That was good for me. I don't know whether it was so good for Spiegel, but...
You got some money
anyway,
from them.
So I got what?
You got some money from them.
Actually, that was not very much. They just had to pay. No. They just, my contract was running another 2 years, so they had to pay for the for the last 2 years.
Okay.
But then I was really lucky, together with some other people, I was able to buy a TV station. I always wanted to have a TV station, actually. And we were very lucky to buy N24, which was this news channel, and we restructured it and made it profitable and everything, and then we sold it to Springer.
Okay.
Before we sold it, Matthias Döpfner asked me whether I wanted to work there as a Herausgeber, publisher, it's not really publisher, the publisher is the, but he always, you know, presents me as the publisher. Anyway. Of Welt and Welt am Sonntag, and I agreed because I like to make newspapers, and especially I always wanted to put a TV station and TV programs and internet and a magazine or a newspaper together, and I always wanted to do that at Der Spiegel, and they were too stupid. No, it's true. And so I agreed to do it. And then, so when I started working there, there was a big meeting of bank people, you know, because it's an AG.
Yeah.
And I had to hold a speech, and I was not prepared to do it. So I said, ladies and gentlemen, dear capitalists. So I had the first.
Here I am.
And then I said, a lot of people ask me, why? What are you doing at Springer? And I said, I always wanted to get in here. So on in 69, we were standing, 68, no, 69. Mm. We were standing in front of the door and wanted to get in. They wouldn't let us in. Yeah. So now here I am.
Yeah, here I am. In 1946, when you were born, in the 40s and 50s, that's exactly where I wanted to go. What kind of a country, what kind of a Germany were you born into? Because that must have been quite a different Germany from the one we know today.
You don't remember, huh?
I don't. I was born in 70.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's true. It was not a country. It was not a state. It was half a state. Mm-hmm. It was half a country. Mm-hmm. And it was, we had a provisional capital, mm-hmm. like Bonn. Everything was a little bit provisional. And we were not a sovereign state. And we were part, and that was the good thing for Germany for the first time. We have been part of the Western democracies. Mm. And at the same time, we were part of NATO and part of one side in a very dangerous situation, which people who think about dangerous situations nowadays have forgotten. Mm. We had a border in the middle of the country, not quite in the middle, but on the right side. And it was the most dangerous line in the world. Mm-hmm. If one of the two sides would have crossed the border, we would have been in the Third World War. Mm-hmm. We had nuclear weapons on both sides, and it was a very, very dangerous situation. But nevertheless, people see their own lives. They see their neighbors. They work. They love. They travel, and so they didn't realize in what kind of a different and situation we were. On the other hand, it's sometimes good when you're not able to make decisions. Mm-hmm. So the German politics was made in Washington, and mainly in Washington. Mm-hmm. Now we are in a situation, it's a bigger country, it's a more or less sovereign state, and we have to make our own decisions, and that's not that easy. Mm-hmm.
The reason I'm asking is it was a country with a history, with a recent history as well. And I want to show you a picture of a young Ulrike Meinhof. Mm-hmm. Ulrike Meinhof is, we mm-hmm. see there.
Oh, I remember that picture.
You yes. remember that picture? And Ulrike Meinhof, of course, is some years older as you are. I think
12
she was
years
born
older.
In 34.
I think she's 12 years older.
Yeah, 30, yeah, whatever.
I think so, yes.
Yeah. And in her early text, I remember she reacted against that this recent history of Germany, the Nazi period, the Third Reich, even though it was so recent, it was not present anymore.
But it was very close. Mm-hmm. And the war was over, but it was very close. And at school, we didn't learn much about the Nazi system because mainly all our teachers have been in any kind of way involved in that system. Mm-hmm. Most of them, at least. Mm-hmm. Actually, I think my Latin teacher was a former general, mm-hmm. The director of the school we had been a pretty strong Nazi, and my mm-hmm. German teacher as well. So they were all in a certain way involved. Mm. And
most of the politicians were.
Not most of the politicians. Adenauer was not a Nazi. Mm-hmm. The really strange, well, but his Secretary of State, mm-hmm. No, Kanzleramtsminister ist etwas anderes, mm-hmm. Globke, mm-hmm. Was a Nazi. Mm-hmm. He was a commentator of the race laws, Nuremberger Rassegesetze. Mm-hmm. He always claimed to have been in the resistance as well, which was not very convincing. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, Germany was not built on a green field.
No.
It was built on the remains of the Third Reich. Mm-hmm. And because so many people have been involved in that system, sometimes they have been members of the party and they have been generals, whatsoever. But a lot of people, I would say the majority, was definitely involved in that system. Mm-hmm. And I think the West, the Allied troops who won the war, did something right, although it was hard to understand at that time. They knew that they had to build the new country with the same people. What else should they do? Mm-hmm. I think Adenauer said, if you have only dirty water, you use the dirty water because you don't have clean water. Mm-hmm. And you couldn't have put everybody who was involved in the Nazi terrorist system into prison. You wouldn't have enough prisons for that. Mm-hmm. So I think there was no other way to do it that way. So at that time, there was always a part of the population, you know, thinking it's not good that the old Nazis are teachers, and the others who were guilty, who had to wear their guilt, and I can understand that they wouldn't like to talk about that all the time. Mm.
If we look at this picture of the young Ulrich Meinhof, you were quite right saying that, of course, Germany was not built on a green field and there is a certain continuity and you had to work with the dirty water. And then you had the global situation, the German divide and kind of Western Germany being part of NATO. And then you had the Wirtschaftswunder, so things went mm-hmm. good economically. But then there was this new generation beginning mm-hmm. to ask the parents. Mm-hmm. I remember some of the first text of Ulrich Meinhof in the 15 mm-hmm. was, she was outrageous of this human crime mm-hmm. not being publicly discussed. Everybody mm-hmm. knew it, but nobody talked about it. What role did the press, the journalism, did Der Spiegel play in kind of the early years of the Western Germany?
Well, Rudolf Augstein, when he was asked what the biggest thing in war is he ever did, was my retreat from Ukraine with a bicycle, mm-hmm. his. Mm-hmm. And he was not a Nazi. Mm-hmm. And he was able after the war to start with Der Spiegel. But when Spiegel became 50 years old, I think. Mm. I think it was for the 50th anniversary.
So that was 2000 and...
Yeah, it was founded in, must be 99, I mm-hmm. guess.
Yeah.
I think 49 and 99, mm-hmm. yeah. Mm. It was interesting. A journalist, whom I know pretty well, a rather good friend, he wrote a story for the 50th anniversary of the old Nazis being at Der Spiegel. Mm-hmm. Then, because they had some old Nazis there, mm-hmm. They were gone and dead at that time when I was there. But in the early years, mm-hmm. and it was interesting. He called me and he offered me that text, mm-hmm. and I said, "Oh, that's interesting." And at the same time, he was talking with Manfred Bissinger with Die Woche. You mm-hmm. know, it was a weekly newspaper. But he offered it to me first, and I called Rudolf Augstein. I said, "Rudolf, Hachmeister, Lutz Hachmeister is presenting a story about the old Nazis at Der Spiegel. Shall we print it?" Mm-hmm. And he said, "No." And I said, "Why not? If we are not going to print it,
somebody
Die Woche
else
will print it."
Mm-hmm.
And he said, "Yes, but not Der Spiegel." Mm-hmm. So he was, in a certain way, reluctant himself to talk about old Nazis that have been working at Der Spiegel. Mm-hmm. It was not very many, and not for a long time, and not very important Nazis, but there have been some who had been working at the press department and during the war, mm-hmm. things like that. And another thing which is very interesting, I think in the 50s, they published a series about the burning of the Reichstag. Mm-hmm. And And that kind of set the standard of how you look at the burning of the Reichstag. Mm-hmm. And I think the story was not accurate. Mm-hmm. I'm just reading a book, and it just came out a couple of, I don't know, months ago, mm-hmm. by an English professor, very interesting book, mm-hmm. Burning the Reichstag. Mm-hmm. And if you look at that, you see that this old Nazi system, who helped him to write this story about the Reichstag, was active at that time. And mm-hmm. and they told them a pretty wrong story.
Okay.
I mean, it's not proven that the Nazis did it, but it's very likely. Mm-hmm. And the Spiegel told the story of the one. So it was not totally clean. But in the end, Spiegel played very, although there have been a few people, they played a very important role in the process of democraticizing Germany.
But looking back from today again, I mean, today we think that democracy is root-vested in German society, but still in the 50s and 60s, with the Spiegelaffäre,
and oh, yes.
wasn't it still, and coming from the Nazi period, wasn't it a very repressive state, and civil society has not been established at the time so much as we know it today.
Not as much as we know today, then it was better, but it was better than ever before in Germany.
Okay.
I mean, that if you look back through the centuries, it was the first more or less functioning democracy. Mm-hmm. It was a liberal state, although in parts it was much more conservative than it is now. But I think the Germany of the 50s and 60s, if you regard the past, they did their homework.
Mm-hmm. I want to show you a little clip from a film that, of course, you know, because you might not know. Of course, you know that Stefan Aust has written this book, Der Baader-Meinhof Complex.
You which know what? Was when I see that picture of Rudi Dutschke with that pullover, that sweater, I can smell it.
Really? Yeah. but this, your book.
It's in the Museum of German History now.
Really? In Berlin.
That ugly piece, yes.
We see. But the film clip is from a film that was not based on your book, the other way around. The film was made out of your book and kind of shows how the first generation of the RAF, the Rote Armee Fraktion, kind of turned from, like in the case of Ulrich Meinhof, from being a journalist to actually going into terrorism. Mm-hmm. And there's a scene in the beginning where you actually are part of. There's a garden party in Sylt, and the new Konkret mm-hmm. has just been published, and Ulrike Meinhof is reading a text about...
It's fiction.
It's fiction?
No, it's in a certain way fiction, because I know the scene. Mm. It was... I'm an actor is playing me, you know, coming to this party, and I'm delivering some kind of
a
paper, exactly. The new edition with an open letter of Ulrike Meinhof to Farah Diba.
Exactly,
you know?
Yeah.
That's true, mm-hmm. and the text is true, and the scene is a little bit like that, but not on Sylt, but so that's fiction. But
the interesting thing, and this is what I want to show now, is what is happening in Berlin at the time, under the visit of the Shah.
And that is very, in the film, very close to what actually happened.
That's what I want to show. Let us see, it's 5 minutes of of your film, but I thought when I saw it, it was a very impressive scene, kind of giving a feel of the time at the time. Yeah, 1968.
Mm. Actually, that scene is very, very close to reality. Before we shot it, we looked at every picture, every TV scene from that. So it's very, very close. It's like if you compare it to the documentary pictures, it's just like the same, only in color. And it's very, very close.
It's of course
every detail
Benno
is correct.
Benno
Ohnesorg was shot. And I mean, the strange thing, which we didn't know at that time when we made the film, the guy who shot Koras just died, I think, 2 weeks ago. Mm-hmm. And he was an agent of East Germany, which nobody could believe at that time.
I'm born 2 years later, and of course I show you the scene to get a feel of kind of what it was, to what kind of a Germany it was at the time. And the question
that didn't happen every day.
No, no, I know, but it was a reason why the Rote Armee Fraktion came into existence. This was kind of a reaction to that as well.
I think the policeman Koras, that East German agent Koras, did more for, I would say, more for the creation of the Red Army faction than Andreas Baader. It's probably scenes like that.
I know you have written a very thick book about the whole Rote Armee Fraktion, but not everybody in the room will have read it. Why did it start? What kind of people were the fundament of the Rote Armee Fraktion? Ulrike Gemeinhof is only one.
You know, all the people who went to demonstrations like that, and have been in political groups like that, and they had their political ideas, some more radical, some less radical, and then they came into this situation. Suddenly they saw the police, when you're really beaten down by the police and treated in a way like that, you suddenly have the feeling, you know, the fascist state comes back. And at that time, a lot of people who took part in this movement, which was not, you know, some movement where everybody thought in the same way, were very different factions. There were liberals and there were old-time Orthodox communists, like actually Ulrike Meinhof. She was a member of the communist, the at that time forbidden Communist Party, which nobody knew. I didn't know it either. And at that time, when the police started using force and against the students, they had the idea to answer with force themselves, with violence themselves, and there it was some kind of an escalation process. They started to have a demonstration on places or in streets where demonstrations were not allowed. Then the police came. Then they threw eggs on the America House in Berlin. Then Molotov cocktails and stones and everything. So it was a process of escalation, and at the same time, so one of the big issues was the German past. It was the time of the Grand Coalition, of the big coalition between the SPD and the CDU, and with Willy Brandt as vice chancellor,
and
Kiesinger, who had been a member of the NSDAP, was the chancellor. The first chancellor who had been a member of the NSDAP came into government with the help of the Social Democrats. So that's why a lot of people said, "Wer hat uns verraten, Sozialdemokraten?" And at that time, a lot of people talked about Gewalt, about violence. When I made a documentary about at least a couple of documentaries, I just made one actually, about West Berlin, between the building of the wall and the fall of the wall. And this was certainly, as you can imagine, a big part in that film. And there was an interview with Rudi Dutschke, where he was claiming that we would need force and violence. So there were a lot of people talking about violence, and then some of these people had the idea violence could not only be throwing stones, but shooting and robbing banks.
How much was the Rote Armee Fraktion, I'm not saying a reaction to, maybe a reaction to kind of a German question, like the German state, but in this film and in your book, it's quite clear that other events in the world, like the Vietnam War, also played a role.
It was a time of a global war, of not only a Cold War, it was a war between East and West, if you put it like that. And the West had their countries in the Third World, and the East had other countries in the Third World. So it was It was the time of the liberation of the Third World, the Cuban Revolution, revolutions in Africa, in South America, everywhere. And people in Germany, young people, students, became engaged to fight for the freedom of these countries. Sometimes, when these countries had a revolution afterwards, it was not better than it was before. Mm-hmm. Iran has not been better after the Shah than before when the Shah was there. Mm-hmm. And in Cuba, it was not that funny during the first decades with the Castro regime as well. Mm-hmm. And so they identified with these countries and tried to be part of this worldwide struggle against imperialism and capitalism whatsoever. Mm-hmm. And some of them then got the idea, if we fight a war against imperialism, against the Americans in Vietnam, we do not want to stop the war in Vietnam, mm-hmm. but we want the Americans being beaten in mm-hmm. Vietnam. So then it's very easy to get the idea, I have to join these forces. And because they didn't want to go to the jungle, some people did, mainly in South America, not in Vietnam. So they started to be some kind of a little unit of the global struggle against capitalism and imperialism. So in a certain way, it was a logical process of thinking going that way.
Mm-hmm. Even though the 60s were, as you say, a time where kind of young people became critical, there was a lot of talk about violence and counter-violence. But some people, some intellectuals, they stayed before the line of violence, like Rudi Dutschke didn't cross it, you didn't cross it.
Well, I was always feeling, as a journalist, mm-hmm. even during the time when I was working for Concrete, actually I was not there on the 2nd of June, 67, mm-hmm. but I was there when Rudi Dutschke was shot down. Mm-hmm. So I was very close, but I always had the feeling I do not want to spend my life in prison, and I don't want to kill or hurt other people. I mean, that decision for me was always very clear, and I was always against Sekten, wie würdest du Sekten übersetzen?
Yeah, Sekten.
And I never had this religious feeling that I have to, you know, save the world. Mm. And a lot of writers. So I have a very good friend. Actually, he has birthday today.
Okay.
And I couldn't go. Peter Schneider.
Yeah.
Yeah, he has birthday today. And I was invited, and said I couldn't come because I'm here.
Don't it's call true. Him now. You can call him later.
Yeah, I will call him later. They were writing articles demanding for violence and for war. Mm. And I remember when I was working for Concrete, we had a story of Peter Weiss, you know, the German author, who was living in Sweden, I think, at that mm. time.
Yeah.
And he was calling and he said, schafft ein, zwei, drei viele Vietnams. Mm. And I had a big discussion with Klaus Ranerühl, the publisher, and I said, I thought we would wanted to stop that war. Mm. Now we are demanding more wars. And then he tried to explain, and he said, I will never be really on the radical left side. Mm. I said, you are right, but now he's on the very right side.
But how do you explain that people then crossed this line? I mean, you know Ulrike Meinhof quite well. You were colleagues. She was the chief editor at the time in Concrete. People might not know, but actually you were the one saving or bringing back her children from Sicily after she went underground. So how do you explain that? And Gudrun Enslin, she was the daughter of a priest. I mean, she grew up in a quite bürgerlich home.
But I think this religious moment was very important for them. Mm. I remember the scene is in the film too, and it's a real scene. It was after they burned down a department store, or set fire, they didn't burn it down, set fire in a department store in Frankfurt, and Gudrun Enslin was in prison. There was an interview on Panorama with her father, mm-hmm. and the question was, What do you think about all this, and how is your relation towards your daughter now, when she, after she's in prison?
Mm. And Jörg Gemeinhof is listening to that, isn't he?
Yeah.
In the film, anyway.
Yeah. In the film, yes, mm-hmm. The scene is real, that she visited her, mm-hmm. but it was not the same scene. Mm-hmm. So we put a lot of things together. And her father said, er hatte den Eindruck einer ganz heiligen Selbstverwirklichung. I mean, a holy self...
Fulfilling
something. Mm-hmm. And I thought, when I saw that interview part and listened to that first, I thought he had understood what was going on there. Mm-hmm. So it was Selbstverwirklichung. Mm-hmm. Und das, that means that you do something which is bigger than yourself. Mm-hmm. And so I always had the feeling, even when they were talking about politics, that it had a very religious dimension. Mm-hmm. And a religious dimension in a second way too. At that time, nobody had the idea that you could have suicide bombers in the world. Mm-hmm. That was not very common at that time. But I remember that suicide played an important role there, the idea of suicide. Mm-hmm. In almost every prison cell in Stammheim prison, they had actually two books. They had a lot of books, mm-hmm. but everybody had two books. One was Moby Dick, which is very interesting because that story has a lot to do with this group, you know, fighting the Leviathan. The Leviathan is the state and so mm-hmm. on. But what I want to say is another one, it's Bertolt Brecht, Die Maßnahme.
Yeah.
Und piece of Bertolt Brecht, there is a very important sentence, and I found it in one letter of Ulrike Meinhof, and it says, furchtbar ist es zu töten, aber nicht anders, so it's terrible to kill.
To kill.
Furchtbar ist es zu töten, aber nicht andere nur, auch uns töten wir, wenn es Not tut, da doch nur mit Gewalt diese tötende Welt zu verändern ist, wie jeder Lebende weiß. So, it's terrible to kill somebody, mm-hmm. but not only others do we kill, we kill ourselves as well, because it's necessary to kill in during these killing times, as every living person knows. Mm-hmm. So they always put their own destiny behind the destiny of the world, and I'm always getting very skeptical when people love thy neighbor more than themselves.
Mm-hmm. Andreas Bader, again, when you see the film, read your book, he seemed to be a quite charismatic person, kind of
at least,
leader, maybe a
understand the girls, I don't know.
Yeah.
He obviously had some influence on women, mm-hmm. mainly.
Yeah.
Most of the guys I know, you know,
they didn't
at like least it. Those who did not submit themselves say he's an asshole. Mm. If you talk to some people who knew him quite well from the students' movement. Mm-hmm. He was a very aggressive, authoritarian guy, but who had obviously a certain charisma. Actually, I never met him. Mm-hmm. I never met him personally, and I never met Gudrun Enslin. I knew Ulrike Meinhof quite well, as you said, I knew Horst Mahler quite well, and a lot of other people, not him. But sometimes, maybe, when you start an expedition like that, you need the scientists first, like Gudrun Enslin and Ulrike Meinhof, who say, you know, this is the big goal we are going to do. But when it's going down the wild river in the jungle, you need people who can kill a crocodile. Mm-hmm. So in a certain way, he got into his role during the time underground, mm-hmm. and actually in prison as well. He was a very strong personality. Which are not always the best characters. Mm.
So as we speak about terrorism, and if we look at the Rote Armee Fraktion as one example of terrorism, then you have kind of a cocktail, which is, you named it, there's a certain something you could compare to a religious belief, mm. there's a certain charisma of one of the leaders, and there's a clearly defined enemy. Mm-hmm. Like the German state at the time, or the authorities, or the American soldiers, the Vietnam mm-hmm. War, the capitalist mm-hmm. system. Are those general ingredients of terrorism?
Well, definitely. And the more you fight a system, the more you have the idea, which they wrote it in that way. We are trying to force the state to show its fascist face. And then if you try to do that, and you throw bombs, and you have to do with the police and secret service and everything, then from your individual point of view, it looks like that. It's getting worse and worse. Mm-hmm. And when you're in prison then, you know, you just see the walls, and you see the guards, and so suddenly the whole country looks like that. Mm-hmm. So the personal view on this situation, on this government, on the state, becomes more and more self-fulfilling. Mm-hmm. But what's very interesting, I mean, we were talking about, you know, the situation that in Germany it was the Vietnam War and the German past, mm-hmm. mainly, mm-hmm. some other topics as well. At the same time, you had terrorist groups in other countries as well. Mm-hmm. So sometimes I feel like in the film, that I always, you know, have been in interesting situations when something was really happening at that time, mm-hmm. And I was in America in after I left Concrete in '69, mm-hmm. and I was living with some people in New York. And one evening, there was a group coming, discussing a political situation and their political plans. Mm-hmm. And they had a paper, I remember it that night, with a headline, "You don't need a weatherman to know which way the wind blows." That's a phrase mm-hmm. from Bob Dylan out of that song. Mm-hmm. And that was a group that called themselves the Weatherman Faction. Mm-hmm. And that was exactly the same, or almost the same, as the Red Army Faction did in Germany a little bit later. So, and I had just been in San Francisco and had a lot to do with the Black Panther Party. So you maybe remember Erich Kleaver was on flight. He was in Algiers at that time, mm-hmm. and other people were in prison because this group, the Black Panther Party, started to run around with guns in the ghettos. Mm-hmm. So when Bernardine Dorn and Mark Rudd and others who founded that group came to explain that, I said, well, wait a minute, I just come back from San Francisco and saw what happened to the Black Panther Party. And do you really want to do that? Mm-hmm. And they started and they went underground and they killed a few people. And the most interesting thing is, years later, I think I was there in 69, and mm-hmm. I think 25 years later or something, I don't know. I made a film with that Hachmeister together, who mm-hmm. wrote about the Nazis at Der Spiegel, mm-hmm. a film about the year 69. And I mm-hmm. thought, maybe I find Mark Rudd again, who was the head of the Black Panther Party. He was out of hiding, went to prison not for a very long time, and is a professor in Santa Fe now. And I mm-hmm. found him, and I made an interview with him, mm-hmm. and because we knew each other from that time. And I said, how was it? And he said, when he was in that terrorist group, he looked into a big, big hole. Mm-hmm. And he said, no, I'm not going to do that. So he dropped out of it, mm-hmm. Left that group, and worked as a worker for years until the police found him. Mm-hmm. So there were groups, similar groups, all over the world. You had the Red Brigades in mm-hmm. Italy, you had terrorist groups in Japan, in America. But the most violent groups of these were in former fascist countries. Mm-hmm. The Germans, the Italians, and the Japanese.
Mm-hmm. I have two more questions for the left-wing mm-hmm. terrorists. Let's maybe see some pictures, because it was quite a turbulent time. There was the young Ulrike Meinhof Then we have Benno Ohnesorg there.
You see, that picture is exactly like in the film.
Yeah, we can go back.
Even the car plate is the same number.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So here, Rudi Dutschke, the sweater that you still can smell. And then, of course, they were searched for, they went underground. It's spreading more and more. Hans-Martin Schleyer, that was around 77, wasn't it?
77, yes.
77, of course. And then kind of there was the dead in Stammhain, Andreas Bader, Gundrun Enslin. And that's Herhausen. The next generation, Alfred Herhausen in the 80s, and this is Detlef Rohwedder in 1991. So this was kind of a poke in German history. And there was a funny thing in your film, it's only a kind of a side remark, but it seemed when Willy Brandt became chancellor with his slogan,
Mehr Demokratie wagen,
it is as if the public, kind of the talk about violence, kind of ebbed a little bit down. Mm-hmm. Could the German state have reacted differently in the 70s? Because it was kind of, we talk about the Deutsche Herbst, mm-hmm. It was kind of both sides, they aufrüsten, würden wir sagen auf Deutsch.
Yeah, but that's a different development. Mm-hmm. The students movement, when the people went on the street and all these things around Rudi Dutschke and Benno Ohnesorg happened, that was the time of the big coalition. Mm-hmm. And Willy Brandt was vice chancellor.
Yeah. And it was 69.
And you always have in a situation when the governing parties are too big, when you have a grand coalition, you get radical oppositions. Mm. It's always the same. There was this violence on the street, and I think that government nevertheless reacted quite reasonable. Mm. They tried to get the people back into they made an amnesty and all this. Actually, the sons of Willy Brandt were members of that scene as well, mm-hmm. and they were put on trial as well, mm-hmm. and their defense attorney was Horst Mahler. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was a strange situation if you imagine what kind of changes these people made. I mean, Horst Mahler is in prison now because of denying the Holocaust. Mm-hmm. He got 12 and a half years for that.
Yeah.
And he's on the very radical right side. I visited him in prison, actually, because I have quite a close relationship to him because he wanted to kill me. So, and if anybody wants to kill you and he doesn't succeed, you know,
you're
superior. You survived him. Yeah. So I survived
Why, him. Why, you said Horst Mahler wanted to kill you. I read somebody else that those Bader and Enslin tried to kill you as well.
No, Bader and Mahler. Bader and Mahler.
Why?
Oh, that's a long story, I do it short. When Ulrike Meinhof went underground, she had two children, twins, girls, that were, I think, 7.5 years old at that time. Mm. And because she wanted to become a revolutionary and in the underground, she didn't need the children anymore. So she gave up the children, and they were brought across the green border to Italy, to Sicily. Mm. And the father looked for them with police and Interpol and everything, and they didn't find them. And then I got the information where the kids were. So and I thought, and they wanted to bring the children to the Near East, to some kind of a El Fatah camp for revolutionary kids, where they, the 7-year-old girls from Hamburg, were supposed to. Fight to learn to be a fighter. Mm-hmm. So, and I thought that was not very good for them, and I got the information where they were, so I went there, I pretended to be from the group, mm-hmm. I took the children, gave them back to the father. And when they came back from the Near East, from this El Fatah military camp, they found out who it was who took the children, and then they were standing in front of our door in the middle of the night and wanted to shoot us, and we got warned and could get away. So,
but that was more a personal thing.
It was a personal thing. Yeah. Yes.
But coming back to those kind of early 70s and the early period of Willy Brandt, would you say there was kind of the one thing was that the politics changed, that kind of his slogan, Mehr Demokratie wagen, did that the confrontation between the students mm-hmm. and the state became leveled out. And on the other hand, mm-hmm. that what the RAF did, the violence, mm-hmm. people distanced themselves from.
Yeah, it's a rather easy to understand a process. I mean, Willy Brandt did the right thing when he became chancellor. They tried to calm it down and to get the people who had been on the street into politics, you know, normal mm-hmm. politics again. And there were a lot of people who tried to do that, what Rudi Dutschke called Marsch durch die Institution. So yeah. they went into the Jusos and everything. So the whole movement went down. Mm-hmm. And then there were people who were feeling that it is awful that this movement is going down.
Yeah.
So if you don't have the masses, you have to get the weapons.
Yeah.
That was mainly the idea.
Okay. Yeah. What are the lessons learned from this kind of terrorism? Because it went on in the 80s and even in the 90s that you had Bud Kleinen as the last, and at the end of the 90s, the IRF gave up, basically.
Well, after 28 years, I mean, that's more than twice as long as Hitler's regime. I mean, if you just think it on the time.
But clearly you had a climax in the 70s.
Yeah, in 77. Mm-hmm. And, you know, after what we call the German autumn in 77, after the Schleyer kidnapping and the hijacking of the Lufthansa plane and the suicide of Bader and Enslin, Ulrike Meinhof killed herself mm-hmm. earlier, the idea they had to be able to force the government to get the prisoners out of prison. That was gone. Mm-hmm. Because Helmut Schmidt, chancellor at that time, was very strict and he said, we are not going to let them out. Mm-hmm. And in the end, Helmut Schmidt was very lucky that the German police force, GSG 9, mm-hmm. Was able to get the passengers out of that plane in Mogadishu. He would have resigned if that would have ended in the bloodbath, I know, mm-hmm. it, he told him to me. So the idea was obsolete, mm-hmm. to get anybody out of prison. So the rest of the second or third generation, however you call it, changed their tactics. And the tactics was not taking hostages and trying in order to get the prisoners out, mm-hmm. but was just, you know, setting traps and just killing people, mm-hmm. Point blank.
In order to achieve what?
In order to achieve nothing. It was just, you know, we are just killing somebody.
Hate,
yes. Yeah. And to show we are there and we are killing people. So for instance, the Rovere, actually, most of what happened at that time is not really clear. Mm. So
you have
ideas who killed Herrhausen, Rohwedder, nobody knows, but Rohwedder was the head of the Treuhand, mm-hmm. that was after reunification. Mm. And so maybe they had the feeling to get some support from the old communists in the East,
okay.
But they were on the other side already. Mm. And then they didn't have any support. And you can see with the development of the Red Army faction, they were pretty strong because they had a lot of supporters in the beginning, because they during the time of the students' movement, they were all together, and a lot of people shared their goals, but not their means. But nevertheless, they helped them with a little bit of money, just in the beginning, then they robbed banks and had enough.
Apartments,
passports, things like that. Mm. But that went down when everything, what they did, became really cruel. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people who supported them, at least with a little bit, withdrew their support. Mm. And that was in the end, was the end of that group.
So is that, if we look at other forms for terrorism, if we look at the ES today, I know you cannot compare that directly.
But you can compare a lot of things.
Yeah, we'll come back to that. But is this kind of the right cocktail or the right medicine against terrorism is kind of the combining the Willy Brandt and the Helmut Schmidt way, kind of on the one hand being strict, saying mm-hmm. we do not give in, mm-hmm. we do not let the prisoners out in that sense, mm-hmm. and on the other hand,
which is terrible for somebody being a hostage.
Yeah.
I mean, Helmut Schmidt always said it killed Schleyer.
Yeah.
I mean, the first kidnapping was in Berlin. Mm-hmm. That was the Bewegung 2. Juni. They kidnapped the head of the Conservative Party of the CDU, mm-hmm. Peter Lorenz, who was running for mayor in West Berlin. And they put him in prison, and they said, we want to get the following list of people out of prison. Mm-hmm. But they were smarter, because nobody who was on that list had committed a murder.
Okay.
So it was not such a big, you know, stick they had to jump over. But never, and then they let him free. But even at that time, afterwards, Helmut Schmidt, who was chancellor at that time, and he agreed to that, mm-hmm. although they could have done in Berlin whatever they wanted because they were not part of the Federal Republic. But if he wouldn't have agreed, they wouldn't have done it. Mm. But nevertheless, afterwards he said that was a big mistake because they got Lorenz out, but they gave them hope to do another kidnapping and get them out. So he thinks that being weak in the Lorenz case was pretty bad for Hans-Martin Schleyer. Mm. So that was one thing. And sometimes, I mean, you need the police, no doubt about that. Mm. And you need a special unit like the GSG 9 to get the passengers out of that plane.
But do I understand you right? When you say that actually the German state in the 70s and 80s handled the confrontation by the RAF quite well.
Well, if you look on it from today, I would agree. Mm-hmm. At that time, you know, I was working for Panorama, and I did a lot of films about solitary confinement and the new laws against the lawyers and everything. But I think we were right to criticize that and look on that, but if you look back from today, we mainly stayed, you know, inside the democratic rules. Mm-hmm. If you see it like that, I mean, if you compare it with, I mean, you. 9/11 was a very special thing, but nevertheless. And I do understand that the Americans afterwards went after Al-Qaeda and went to get Bin Laden and sent their troops to Afghanistan, but they made a lot of mistakes at that time, and you could see it was not a very good idea to invade Afghanistan and stay there. Mm. They are still there. And the worst, even worse thing was going into Iraq, and some of the problems we have now are the results of that time. There is no doubt that Saddam Hussein was a terrible dictator, mm-hmm. but you know, during that time, that when they prepared their war against Saddam Hussein, I was editor in chief of Spiegel, and I was in Washington quite some often and had a lot of discussions with politicians, mainly from the Democratic side, and even they were in favor of that war, and they said, "Isn't Saddam Hussein a terrible dictator?" Mm-hmm. I said, "Yes, he is. There are certainly a lot of reasons to get rid of him, mm-hmm. but there's one point in wars." That you should not neglect. Mm. You have to win it. Mm. And it was not really likely that they would win the war. Mm. And you can get rid of Saddam Hussein, but what then? So a part of that mess we have there now is the result of that. And if you then think about Guantanamo, mm-hmm. and Abu Ghraib, and waterboarding and torture to get any kind of news out of prisoners, mm-hmm. That has destroyed a lot of American democracy at that time. Yeah.
Created a new enemy.
Oh, sure. And when you fight an enemy, a terrorist enemy like that, you have to see that you don't go into his trap. Mm. So I made a film for ARD called "The Trap 9/11,"
yeah.
And I think they made every mistake they can make.
Let's stay in Germany in the 90s, just a couple of more pictures. Oh, time is running so fast. 9:15. This is Bud Klein. This is actually, this is Hans-Peter Feldmeier, who did a work about Die Toten. We don't have to talk about this. There's an artist. But this is, I want to talk, this is Rostock-Lichtenhagen, right after unification. You see people attacking a block with lots of foreigners. You see the Nazi, Heil Hitler there. Then you have the terrorist, which you have written the news, the latest book about, the NSU case. So there, kind of, I don't know if you can compare that terrorism, but it, at least it comes from the other side, comes from the right-hand side. Can you compare those events which we've seen lately?
In a certain way, yes. If you look on Rostock-Lichtenhagen, that's very interesting. I remember that weekend when it happened. Mm-hmm. Actually, it was not one weekend, it was two or even three weekends.
Yeah, it was 1992, wasn't it? 91, 92?
I think so. So I was working for Spiegel Television, and we got news material about that case, and we made a very short film on that Sunday night, where it had happened. I think it had started on Saturday or something. And I had the feeling that this would go on. Mm-hmm. And I sent a camera crew, or even two, there. And the week later, on Sunday night, I wanted to make a film for the whole program, one 45 minutes piece. So we put the material of the weekend before and the material of the whole week together, and I called a colleague and I said, can you make a film out of that? Mm-hmm. And I looked at the film and I said, there's something missing. And Beate said, what is missing? I said, I remember from the first weekend, we had film sequences, how it started. That you had immigrants who were doing kind of like camping in front of, and it was all very dirty, very ugly, terrible. And so it started. Mm-hmm. And she said, yeah, but if we put these scenes into the film, you understand why it happened. I said, this is important. Mm-hmm. We have to understand what happens. We have to understand why the neighbors first were upset about it, and why this attracted the right-winged. And so in order to understand and to fight against it, you have to really understand why it starts. Mm-hmm. And it's in a certain way. I mean, killing is killing. Whether you're right-winged or left-winged or a religious fanatist or whatsoever, you know, killing innocent people or just killing people. Mm. But there are some similarities, and these similarities are always that every terrorist group has some kind of a big movement around them, mm-hmm. and a lot of supporters around them. Mm-hmm. And as we talked, the end of the Red Army faction was because they didn't have sympathizers anymore. Mm-hmm. Nobody agreed with, and nobody helped them. Mm-hmm. That was the moment when they stopped it. Mm-hmm. And they said, you know, we are just by ourselves. Now we lost the war and we stop it. Mm-hmm. So I think it's very important that the scene where they come from withdraw their support. Mm-hmm. And this is, I don't think whether the right-winged, you know, masses are intelligent enough to stop that, but not every right radical is a killer, mm-hmm. but every right radical killer comes out of a right radical movement.
So if we go back to this cocktail which we saw in the late 60s of kind of, you said, a religious belief, some charismatic persons, and a clearly defined state, do you have those ingredients with the right wing, with the NSU in Germany?
I think you have them everywhere.
Okay.
And it's always that people get upset about certain things. You can agree to what they are upset about or not. Mm. But this is always the rather big base out of this these people develop. Mm. I mean, if you look at the right-winged scene, I mean, it's rather big. And I think those who are not violent are the less problem. If they go on the street, let them go on the street. That happens in every country. Mm-hmm. We in Germany are very, because of our past, are especially sensitive about that, mm-hmm. because we know what can develop out of this. Mm-hmm. But it's always a rather big scene. Mm-hmm. So if you look at Bernhard und Mundlos, you know, these
NSU terrorists
who killed these 10 people, mm-hmm. They have supporters, mm-hmm. And I, you know, we wrote a big, together with a colleague, I wrote a rather big book about that affair, and there are a lot of open questions. Mm-hmm. And I think to believe that this group was just three people is not very likely.
Yeah. But isn't a big difference, for example, with the Rote Armee Fraktion, there was always a lot of publicity, there was always a Bekennerschreiben afterwards, I don't know the English word for that.
Yeah.
But the NSU, those, if I understood it right, those murders were, I mean, they were quite, I don't know if you can say so, but anonymous. I mean, they didn't make a big fuss of it. They just killed.
You are right, but they used the same weapon. Mm-hmm. They used
that was the handwriting.
That was the handwriting. That was the thump. Mm-hmm. And I think the police could have known that. The Secret Service, Verfassungsschutz.
Should have known?
No, they knew.
Okay.
I'm quite sure. I'm having a lot of discussions with them. And I just don't believe that they didn't have the idea. They didn't support it. I would never say that the German Secret Service was agreeing and tolerating these killings, not at all. Mm-hmm. But I think they have been very close to them, because there are so many V-Leute, spies, mm-hmm. you know, agents around them, mm-hmm. Who were members of the radical scene as well, that they knew where to look. I'm quite sure.
And what did they want to achieve? Who's the enemy?
You mean
the NSU people?
They were against foreigners, mm. and wanted to show that they can kill foreigners. Mm.
But is there political ideology behind that?
Well, it's very close to the Nazi. Mm. It's exactly the same. Mm.
So, what do we do? I mean, you said you can compare everything, and it kind of seems right now that we. It's a big word, but we live in times of terror. I mean, we have had the Charlie Hebdo, we had mm-hmm. the terror in Copenhagen, we have the ES, which is kind of, it seems to be a new level of cruelty. Mm-hmm. With your experience, and you say that you can compare things, What shall we do with it?
Well, first, there are things that are comparable, but I always tell myself, you know, if you have a hammer, you always look see nails, you yeah. know, so you have to be a little bit careful with that. Mm. But there are similarities. You can see that with the IS. You could see it with 9/11. And one of the main things is that terror is always propaganda, mm-hmm. propaganda with real dead people. Mm-hmm. So it's not just, you know, fighting against the state or whatever, and then being being in power, but it because most of the time they have conflicts with powers that are stronger as they are themselves. So they use the mass media, they use it as a tool of communication. Mm-hmm. So the best example is 9/11. You know, you hijack a few planes, you take the first one, run into tower number one, and then you wait till CNN and all the other are in place, and then the second plane. So mm-hmm. I mean, this is the perfect propaganda mm-hmm. In a terrorist attack. That was during the time when you had streamed television, mm-hmm. news channels, that, and nothing else. Mm-hmm.
Today,
now, if you look at IS, they are the specialists in online propaganda.
Social media.
Social media. Yeah. That's very interesting and mm. very, very dangerous. Mm.
But looking again at the history of the Rote Armee Fraktion, you said at the end, the state, our how do you call that, Rechtsstaat, was stronger and kind of time is on our side. At the end, we'll...
Yeah, it was not good for a lot of people who died in these yeah. in these times, but in the end, they lost their support. Mm-hmm. And I think whatever happens in terrorism, you certainly need secret services if they function, mm-hmm. which is rather important. You need justice system, you need everything, you need police, there's no doubt about that. Mm-hmm. But in the end, you need the support of the community, and of the community out of which these people come.
Okay.
So, and I think this is very important.
Mm-hmm. And if we look at our current examples, then of course we have this discussion of the latest terror coming from within the immigrant circles.
Yeah, but it's not only. I mean, it's terrible when they shoot the people at Charlie Hebdo mm-hmm. or kill other people in Western countries. Mm-hmm. But the biggest number of casualties of dead people are within the Muslim world.
Yeah.
So in a certain way, it's a civil war. And because we do not really have borders anymore, you can go to other countries, mm-hmm. This civil war takes place in other countries. Mm-hmm. But so I think, and you wouldn't have enough police to stop all this, mm-hmm. and you wouldn't have enough armies to stop all this. And if we send the Bundeswehr to the Near East, you know, good luck, I wouldn't do that.
But if with your experience and your knowledge about terrorism, I mean, for the Danish society, the terror attacks here in Copenhagen and at the synagogue, which is quite close here, mm-hmm. it came as a shock, even though kind of we knew that in theory it was possible. So if now the Prime Minister called you tomorrow morning and said, come by for a cup of coffee, I need your advice, mm-hmm. what would your advice
I couldn't
be?
Give him advice.
So if Chancellor Merkel called you and asked the same question?
I can't give her advice as well. Mm-hmm. Actually, the President Köhler once called me mm-hmm. where it was the question of letting Christian Klar out of prison. So I talked about that with him. Mm-hmm. But it's very hard to give advice because those people who have to deal with it in higher levels of the government, they know what they are doing, and they know that it's very hard to calculate. Mm. And you can see what they did after Charlie Hebdo. They always said, in order to keep people quiet and calm, they said, it's not a matter of Islam, it's a matter of Islamism. Mm-hmm. And they tried to divide both, which is all right. But nevertheless, you have to admit that those people come from that Islamic world. Mm. And they have supporters there. Mm. And I think you can only end that war when the Muslim world is dealing with that. Mm-hmm. And maybe that because of this incredible brutality of IS, there are some people who put their oil money into these groups will stop doing that. Mm. I hope so.
But still, as Western societies, we are all confronted at least with the danger of that kind of terrorism, of one single person. And so we have to deal with the problem, or the challenge, as we say in modern speak, and we have to kind of look at past experience and see how different societies at different times have dealt with it. And you are one of the persons who know at least most about terrorism in Germany, both the right-hand terrorism and the left-hand terrorism. And I actually thought you may end up with an advice like kind of this two-hand strategy, the Willy Brandt and the Helmut Schmidt. On the one hand, a hard kind of not going on compromise with certain democratic values. On the other hand, kind of this old Christian biblical thought that you have to reach out your hand
reach
to
out,
your enemies.
But not put your right side for the next clap, nicht? Mm. Nicht, das, nicht die Wange hinhalten. I think you have to defend yourself. You don't have to get into the trap, and you have to see out of which society, parts of the society it comes, which kind of conflicts there are, and you have to see that you reduce these conflicts, so that when you have immigration population, you have to give them chances, and you have to try to convince them that they take care of their children, to go to school and not to go to IS. Mm-hmm. That's very hard, but I don't really know who else should be able to solve that problem.
To the education. And my last question, every challenge, every problem has its time. And right now it seems it's the time of the terror, both within our society, but also in the Muslim world. Do you think it's a question of time? So we in 5-10 years can move on and terror will be a thing of the past? Or do you think we have to get used to living with terror?
I'm afraid we have to live with it.
That's not a very optimistic
No, ending. It's not. But on the other hand, you know, whatever happens can be very bad, very dangerous. Remember, you know, the Eurowing, the German Wings plane and all these. Nevertheless, next day you get into the plane again, and statistic tells you that the next crash won't be with German Wings, but something else. And you have to live with dangers, and you have to live with the feeling that you are not living forever. And if you compare the situation today, I think it's a dangerous period now. But I mean, if you look 70 or 80 years back, you know, it's worse. What our grandfathers and some of them did, some of them went through, is definitely worse. So I hope it won't get worse.
And kind of.
And you know, there. If you look on Europe, I mean, altogether, we have our problems, we have our conflicts, we have the problems with Greece, and I mean. But I mean, compared to what was 70 years ago. Mm. I mean, so actually, I'm sure that my generation, being born after the war, right after the war, living through peace for almost 70 years now, is a rather lucky generation. Mm. And I hope the next will have it the same way. So in a certain way, I'm always optimistic.
You ended up, yes, with the Springer Verlag.
Well, I didn't end up there.
No.
I'm there now. Wait.
For the time being. Stefan Aust, thank you very much. It was a pleasure talking to you. It was always like sitting in front of the chimney. The only thing missing was a glass of wine, but we can get that.
It's true. Why not?
Why not? Thank you very much. Thank you for being here. And
thank you.
Vielen Dank.